Hi, I'm Jeff Schaefer. Today I'm going to show you another flight in this series of flights I've been doing using just the map and compass to navigate. We're not going to use autopilot, we're not going to use GPS, we're not going to use VORs. We're just going to use the map and compass and a little bit of on-the-fly dead reckoning. We're not going to calculate out the winds in advance in order to do the more advanced, more precise dead reckoning you can do using a map and compass. I'm sorry, a sectional chart along with the winds aloft report. Today we're flying from General Fox Airport, very long distance, about 186, I think, nautical miles, past this restricted area to right here. And I believe this is pronounced Chemehuevi Valley. I don't know, but that's how I'm going to say it. So, like I said, the main thing in our way is this restricted area. We also need to worry about the restricted area around Edwards Air Force Base to our north. So, departing, I've chosen a heading of 75 degrees. And 75 degrees, that's my heading bug right there. As you can see, using this VOR as a guide, 75 degrees is right there. That's horizontal along the map. So that means that on departure, I'm not going to get any closer to this restricted airspace as long as I stay at 75 degrees or to the right of 75 degrees. Once I positively identify things out this way, we'll be able to get a better picture of where we are and make sure we're not going into this airspace. As I approach this airspace, which I'm going to be headed straight for, I'm going to need to positively identify other things to make sure I don't fly into it. I'm going to get to the north of it. And then once I'm sure I'm past it, and I can identify maybe these mountains or something, we'll see when we get out here, probably this dry lake, then we're going to make a turn to the south and navigate straight to our destination. This is a long flight in a 172. It could take up to 2 hours, so I'm probably going to split this into two videos, and almost certainly I'll use a little bit of time acceleration here and there to get you past the boring parts. So you won't have to just watch as we go over maybe a big flat desert area or where we've positively identified everything around us. You know, we'll skip past all that stuff. So let's get going. I've already gotten my clearance to taxi. I'm just up here next to runway 24. Right about here. I've already done my run up. I am on pilot edge, so I'm going to call the tower for departure, but we're not going to use flight following, just so I can tell you what I'm doing navigating and not have to worry about talking to them as much. And this is a route you can legally fly. You know, you don't need to talk to anyone once you get out of General Fox's airspace. Even into the MOA, you don't have to talk to anyone. It is a pretty good idea to talk to someone to be on flight following inside the MOA, especially in the real world. Airplanes all over the place in there. I've been into a couple MOAs. I haven't seen too much, but they do a lot of military operations, and it's a good idea to let them know where you are and get an idea of where they are.
Runway 1950 contact SoCal approach 119.6.
So let's get started. I'm already on the tower frequency. You can see I've set my GPS here to kind of do nothing because the point of this flight is no autopilot, no GPS, and no VORs. Just going to use the map and compass. So my departure plan is just to take off, and get on my heading. And here's a good habit to have in a real airplane. Pilot edge, maybe not so much. We want to stick to our habits. Here's the end of the runway. There could be another plane landing. You want to check. I know we're at a towered field, and they're going to tell us not to go, but guess what? If a plane's on short final, it's just more professional to not call the tower for takeoff until after they land. It just creates extra workload. You know they're going to tell you to hold short. and not give you a takeoff clearance yet. So let's call him up. Fox Tower, Cessna 811 Juliet Sierra, ready for takeoff runway 24.
811 Juliet Sierra, Fox Tower, strut departure approved, runway 24, clear for takeoff.
24, cleared for takeoff, 811 Juliet Sierra, thanks. Alright, we're climbing up. Let's take a look at where we are. You can see Palmdale out here. The city. There's also an airport, which I think is right there. See the runway. And let's get out of this turn here. That's the thing with no autopilot. You gotta keep watching where you're going. You can't just count on the autopilot to keep you on heading. So, there's one runway. That should be Palmdale Airport. I'm not sure. Let's say 70%.
Air 46, should we go up Santa Barbara Clarence, stand by 1?
Doesn't make sense. We're in this curve here.
I should say 128 Bravo Delta, Santa Maria Ground.
One runway.
So you're going to request, I couldn't hear you. Technical issue.
There. I think that's it. Let's look out to the left. There's this pretty large...
I want to be Bravo Delta, Santa Maria Ground.
Followed by a big one. So that would be Rosamond, then a small one, then Rogers Lake, where Edwards Air Force Base is. That makes sense. Can we maybe see the runways for Edwards Air Force Base?
R-46, Juliet Golf, Santa Barbara Clarence, aircraft type Pacific.
Okay. I see a runway, some hangars.
It's a Cessna 172. Slant golf.
Now, if this is Palmdale, are we worried about their airspace?
On departure flight runway heading. Maintain BFR. Actually, just verify, you got an IFR flight plan filed. Are you...
No, we're not, because their airspace only goes up to 5,000 feet. I'm already at 6,500 feet.
BFR, I believe. Is that correct?
That's correct. It's VFR. I must have hit it wrong. Oh, want me to go back and do it again?
No. It's an IFR flight plan, so just disregard it. I'll just throw that away. R-62 Golf on departure flight runway heading. Maintain VFR at or below 1,500. Departure frequency 120.55, squawk 4451.
Upon departure,
you can see there's a river there.
Upon departure to runway heading, stay at VFR up to 1,500 feet.
And there's not a river here, but there is this...
The departure frequency is
dry river,
055, and the squawk,
or you know, seasonal river. That's these little dots. And you can see it, you know, the city kind of curves around, airport in the middle, and the dry river on the other end. The city curves around, airport in the middle, dry river. Puts us right up here. Right where we expect to be. That's good. Let's see how we're doing on that heading. Now you'll notice I'm leaning the mixer a little bit. That gives me a little bit better power. You can see they're warning about this exact mixture setting. What we're going to do is bring it out a little bit, get the EGT going, and then adjust it, fine-tune. So we're pretty close in that area. As you can see, the fuel flow gauge moves, but the EGT doesn't really climb as much. There it goes on the way up. Let's get a closer look.
American 464, Los Angeles Center, you're on the wrong frequency contact, Los Angeles Center 125.27.
So I'm using my keyboard to fine-tune, pull the mixture out. Still pulling it out. Just one little click at a time. Just click, wait, click, wait, click, wait. You can see how little it's moving it. Click, wait, click, wait. You see that tiny, tiny little bit. And that's great. Usually in a plane like this, you get what's called a vernier mixture. Sometimes the throttle's that way too, but usually just the mixture. And how that works is you can push this button in, and then the whole mixture knob will freely slide in and out. But you can also just turn the knob, turn this outer area here, left or right, and if you turn left, it'll bring it out very slowly. If you turn right, it'll push it in very slowly. And it allows you to make very, very fine-tuned changes. So, I'm going to pull it out a little bit more.
GA Tom Paterno.
Still going up.
With Yankee, ready to taxi.
We're waiting for it to hit the peak and start coming back down.
46, you go up Santa Barbara ground, you're northeast, northeast.
There's
or
the peak, so coming back down.
Northwest.
So now I'm pushing it back in a little bit. I want to go back through the peak.
R62, go up, thank you, runway 15 right, taxi via Charlie.
And I want to move about one of these marks down. So the peak was about that mark, we're going to move down to this mark. There we go, that's 25 degrees, Rich, off peak. We're going to do this again in a moment when we get up to our cruising altitude of 9,500. And I'm also going to pitch forward just a little bit, get more of a cruise climb. So let's look to the left. There's Rosamond Lake again, the little one, and Rogers Lake, where Edwards Air Force Base is. There's Palmdale Airport again, the city of Palmdale, and the river. So I'm showing you points that I just showed you before. Why? Because it's tempting to kind of go on to the next thing, but it's very important to keep track of the points that you already had before. The biggest mistake I see, especially new students make, is to take off from an airport, get on course, and then have no idea what any of the waypoints are or where they are. When the airport they just took off from is right behind the plane, just a couple miles. So I always tell them, just turn around, look behind you. What do you see? You see the airport we departed from. Well, that's your first checkpoint. That's your very first thing, because you can look behind you at the airport. Right now we're a little far away, but even now we might be able to see it. You can see the runway often. There it is. And from that, you can just infer your rough position, even if you can't get an exact position. So let's do it right now. Right, there's the airport we took off from. And let's stay looking back at it, actually, so we don't get disoriented here. There's the airport we took off from. Okay, there it is. And we can see the runway's at this angle. Right? So we're off that angle, so we know we're out this way. Right? And from the other stuff we saw, we also know we're just off the end of this river, maybe a mile or two. And I'm continuously having to adjust for my bank there, but that's okay. So we're just off the end of the river, so we're right about there.
I was wrong. I was the GA on the east side, not the west side.
8,500 feet, we're going to climb another 1,000.
Roger, runway 15 left, taxi via Charlie.
15 left via Charlie.
This is the SimCoder's Reality Expansion Pack, Cessna 172. And I really like this thing a lot. In fact, I'm running a giveaway on April 2nd, 2018. Filming this before that. I will also run another giveaway for this by the time this video is put out there. So if you want to get in on that giveaway, the details, I think I'll put them in the link for this video. But even if not, you can go to schaeferflight.com, that's S-C-H-A-E-F-E-R, flight, F-L-I-G-H-T.com. That's my blog. On there you're going to find a lot of articles about how to train for the real world, especially in a simulator. So it's all kinds of lessons and tips for pilots, and there's a special focus on using the simulator to carry out your training. If you fly real airplanes, it's going to help you to practice. If you're a student pilot in real airplanes, it's going to shave hundreds or even thousands of dollars off of your cost of training, depending on how much you do in your home simulator. It's really worth checking out. If you get on my mailing list, you're going to get those tips. But you're also going to be entered in the drawing to win this plane and in any other drawings I do in the future, which I will be doing all the time, probably monthly, but at least quarterly. So look for those. And again, if you're on the mailing list, you're entered in all of them.
Alaska 464, contact Los Angeles Center 133.55.
We are at... We are at max gross weight. The temperature out here is approximately standard. See, I started a turn there. Towards the Air Force Base, so that's not ideal. Let's take a look at where the edge of that is. It's pretty close to the dry lake, so I'm not really getting over them yet. I'm still outside that restricted area.
Santa Barbara Ground.
And here's 9500. So let's level off, and then we'll get back to the reference sheet.
Mark 464, Los Angeles Center, contact level 350.
How am I leveling off here? Well, I'm keeping the power at full. I'm pushing the nose forward with the yoke. Well, with the joystick in my case. But I don't want to descend, but I want to get the plane level. If I were lower and I was going to pull the power back, I would still have the power at full right now. Once the airplane speeds up, then I would pull the power back. But at this altitude, there's a lot less air. The engine's already working hard just to get the little bit of horsepower it has. We're going to see how much in a moment. But we are going to end up staying at full power. Pretty sure. We're going to verify it on the chart. There we go. So I'm holding forward with the yoke. And right about there, I'm going to add some trim. There we go. And we'll make little adjustments as we go. I see another dry lake out here, another one out there. We'll check these out in a moment. There. I don't see one on the left. I don't know that that could be Harper Lake, but let's kind of estimate it. If Rosamond, and then Rogers, and then, you know, that distance three more times to Harper Lake. Let's see if that looks about right. Rosamond, Rogers, right? Rosamond is there, Rogers is there. Kind of imagine that distance. Plot it out over the land three more times. Yeah, that's plausible. That could be Harper Lake. And this one here is El Mirage Lake. And as usual, as I always say, I'm 99% sure of that. Not 100%. The moment you say you're 100%, you remove room for doubt. And one of the keys to flying like this, using the map and compass, is to always leave a tiny little bit of room for doubt. Just enough that you don't sit back and say, okay, I know what that is, we're flying there. You're kind of always looking, always making sure that things continue to make sense. And if they don't, well, then it's time to reconsider and consider that maybe you're not right. Maybe you're wrong. We're going to start a little bit of a descent to get back on our altitude. And let's take a look at this reference here. So there's two of these.
Santa Maria Ground, Skyhawk 128 Bravo Delta, East Ramp.
Cruise performance.
VFR departure.
And the difference is the altitude.
See that? 2,000
to 6,000, and this is us, 8,000 to 10,000.
3-0, taxi via Alpha, 128 Bravo Delta.
Now we're going to be interpolating here, because we're at 9,500, we're not at 10,000. We're close to 10,000 now. So what horsepower are we going to fly at? Well, our RPM, this is full power, is 2,500. Here's 2,500, 2,500. They're saying that's between 62% and 65% brake horsepower. And we're not flying for economy here, we're flying for speed. So, hang on, I'm working this descent as I'm talking. So we're going to be a lot closer to the 62% because 9,500 is a lot closer to 10,000 than it is to 8,000. Because there's not much of a difference here, we're just going to say we're at 62% brake horsepower. We're not going to use that number for anything else, so it kind of doesn't matter. How about true airspeed? Is our true airspeed, and I'm sorry, I'm actually in the wrong column. We're really closer to standard, so we're actually going to be at 57 to 61. So let's say we're at 57. True airspeed is going to be between 111 and 112, which is very narrow, so we're at 111. And we should be at 8.2 gallons per hour. It's 8.6 gallons per hour. So maybe we'll be at 8.3 gallons per hour, just to interpolate up slightly. Well, how can we check some of these things? Well, let's adjust using this to check our true airspeed. So what is the outside air temperature?
46 degrees Celsius, set up our approach, cancel out to
I have it in Fahrenheit here at 47 degrees. And this is in Celsius. So, I don't know this conversion off the top of my head. There's a very good rule of thumb for it, but unfortunately I've forgotten it. But it is 8.3 Celsius. So here's how this works. Let's put our heading back in view. We're going to turn this knob until 8.3 degrees Celsius, which is will be nowhere near that precise. But this is 10 here, so 8 is right there. Is lined up with our altitude of 9,500. So 8,000, 9,000, 10,000 right here. So pretty much the top of the 1 should be lined up just to the edge of that mark. Right about there. Now, with that set, this white area here will tell us what our true airspeed is. And we gotta turn left again. Let's take a look. It looks like our true airspeed is about 119 knots or so. It's dropping a little bit as we're climbing back up to 9,500. But it's going to remain in this area between 115 and 120. Now our ground speed, we actually don't have right now because we don't have, we're not using the VORs, we don't have like a DME, we're not using the GPS, and we are not using, well, we haven't yet used the winds aloft to calculate it. We could also calculate it by just using checkpoints along the ground. You know, you measure a distance, you say, okay, I'm here, and when I know that I'm crossing this road, right, that's a certain distance, what's the time it takes to get there? Another way to measure ground speed. We're not going to do that right now, we're just going to focus on the map and compass. So we're passing by this lake, and we can see there's a little airport in there, paved. A lot of runways. And looks like it's probably that. El Mirage, Dry Lake.
Air 464, by the altitude maintain level 290.
And we're just straight off that. I like to use, when I find a runway, I like to kind of look at lining myself up with that runway. So right now, we're lined up perfectly with that runway. So we can just draw an imaginary line right off of this runway, and it puts us right here. We're right on this line, and just by approximation, we're somewhere up in this area. We should be able to see this Victorville Southern California Logistics Airport. And I think I'm seeing it here. Yep. So there's Victorville. Are we worried about that airspace? No, we're going to be above it.
Santa Maria Tower, Skyhawk 128 Bravo Delta.
It goes up to 5,400 feet.
30.
So we'll be above their airspace.
30, put the takeoff on course crew.
Now it's time to think about how we're going to deal with this restricted area.
128 Bravo Delta.
I see some mountains up ahead. These are sort of the mountains that have been to the south of us the whole time. And then there's a little bit, you know, it's been pretty flat. But there's a little bit of a mountain showing up here. There's that Harper Lake we were looking at. A little bit of mountain area starting just to the south of that. And then off the end of Victorville, there's some sort of a little body of water there. Let's take a look. So that's probably this Silver Lake. You can see there's a Mojave River, which it appears that it's dry. It's a dry river. And I don't see a river there. I don't see anything like that. So we're going to be iffy on that checkpoint. But there's Harper Lake. Something built up over here. We're still a little bit off course. So we were just there. We have Victorville off to our right. We think we're seeing Silver Lake. And we really want to find Daggett Airport, really. That would be a great thing to fly over, because then we could follow this highway, and that would keep us north of the restricted area. So there's another highway, Highway 15. Headed up to Barstow, and that's probably this town we're seeing to the north, right? This was Silver City, Barstow would be there, and then whatever dry lake that is. And this should still be that Harper Lake. So let's see if that all kind of makes sense. Right, we had Harper Lake, which is in the restricted area. Silver Lake, Barstow.
Yeah, 471, what's your rear guarding? You say again, your transmission?
And I guess that's Coyote Lake in the distance. So Harper Lake, what I think is Coyote Lake. Silver Lake, which is an actual lake of water. Victorville Airport, still right there. But if that's Coyote Lake, that's in the MOA, which is fine, but it is a little close to the restricted area, so I don't really want to mess with that. We're right about here. So to get there, I'd want to basically stay on my course, but try to identify something where I'm going to turn left and get up to Barstow Daggett. Checking my heading. So remember, I think that's Coyote Lake, but I'm not sure, right? What about this? This could be Coyote Lake, and that could be something even farther along. Let's take a look and see what it looks like. Could be. There's a lot of stuff out here. Maybe I have the scale wrong, and that's really Soda Lake, and Coyote Lake's that little tiny one. Not sure. But if that's Barstow, the city, then Coyote Lake should be past it. And that would be Soda Lake, and this would be Coyote Lake. And this would be just, you know, nothing. It's not really on the map. All right, we're almost off the end of the runway here at Victorville. Our altitude has dropped just a little bit. Raise the nose. It's kind of a lot, but sometimes it's hard to be real, make little tiny changes with the yoke, or with the joystick, I mean. How about these mountains? Any sign of that? Let's see. We're about to cross off the end of the runway. We're right about here. I mean, you can see there's some terrain, these contour lines. It's not much. It's hard to tell. You know, it's not like these big mountains to the south that we're looking at.
Yeah, 47, the traffic, 2 o'clock.
How about Apple Valley Airport? That'd be nice to find. We're basically over Silver Lake now. We just passed being off the end of the runway. And despite my intention to climb, we've actually descended. We're gonna see Apple Valley. We're right about here. It's gonna be off to our right. There's some kind of a power line and a highway. That might be that, I think it was 15 we were looking for. That might be Apple Valley there. Let's see if that sort of makes sense. So, highway, some power lines.
Yeah, 471 contact.
A lot of different stuff going on in here. Apple Valley would be past it. Larger city, Hesperia, to the south. Okay, Apple Valley was about there. Larger city to the south. That's this stuff. Yeah, that makes sense. And we thought this was Barstow, right? So here's a highway leading up to it. Here's possibly another highway leading up to it. So there's sort of two of them there. So adjust the camera so I can see the heading, but okay. One highway, another one. Another one, so there's three. I've only really seen two, but I'm thinking I saw this one and that one. This is also, there's a railroad track leading up to it. So, do we see a railroad? Maybe. It's always a little hard to tell. I think that's a railroad. So we started off here.
Good afternoon, Cactus.
Going all the way there. And we're about here. We're getting near halfway. But right now our goal is to identify Barstow Daggett as if we were going there. Because that's our best checkpoint to cross north of the restricted area. So we think that's Barstow. We think that's Coyote Lake. If that's true, Barstow should be pretty close to the town here, really, and we should be able to maybe see it along the road. Quick look at my heading. So coming out of Barstow, there might be a road. And I see an airport here. I don't really see the road, but sometimes it doesn't load them. That's probably Barstow. Does the lineup make sense? Airport is here, Dry Lake there, and then the city. Well, not for Coyote Lake, so that might be a different lake, or maybe that's not Barstow. It does have the two airports. From where we are down here, we would sort of be more lined up with the left one. We'd sort of be kind of between both, right? Because this one goes off that way. This one shoots off that way. We'd be sort of out in the middle. It would be pointing at us a little bit like an arrow. Okay, and it sort of is. This one goes off that way. This one goes off that way. And we're kind of in the middle. So let's head straight for that airport now. How am I going to set up my heading for this? Well, I'm not going to follow my heading bug anymore. We're going to change the heading bug. Right now I'm pointing straight at it. Is this the proper heading to get there? I don't know. Because the wind will affect it, right? I could might point straight at the airport, but I might end up over there if the wind is pushing from the left, or vice versa. So we're just going to see what that gets us staying on this heading.
You need to call the lowest frequency.
The heading bug here is for reference, but our real goal is to look at the airport and head straight for the airport.
Welcome.
And that's probably Coyote Lake past this mountain here. Coyote Lake, some terrain, which would mean that this dry lake, which is kind of small, isn't really anything. So see, if I just let myself be 100% sure that this was Coyote Lake, I'd be wrong. And, you know, that could lead me to all sorts of places. That's why you don't want to ever be 100% sure. You could be 99% sure, but leave that little bit of room for self-doubt so that you continue to check what you're doing and you don't get complacent about where you are. Am I 100% sure that this is Barstow Airport? No, I'm not. But I'm going to keep checking, and until then, I'm going to operate on the assumption that it is, because I am 99% sure. That should be Soda Lake back there. Yep. Maybe. Or it could be this, Troy Lake, or it could be that. Not sure. Well, I think this is a pretty good middle point to end part one of this video. We're going to get ourselves over to Daggett and then pick up from there. We'll pick up part two of the video. Again, if you want to get this plane, you can get it for $20 on the xplane.org store. It's made by Simcoders. It's called the 172 Reality Expansion Pack. It's an expansion for the default 172 that comes with X-Plane 11. I'm also giving this away on April 2nd, and I'm going to announce the next giveaway, which will be near the end of April, on April 2nd, 2018. I'll make the announcement when that'll be and exactly what it will be. It's not going to be just this plane, it's going to be this plane and something else, so I think you'll like it. You can go to my website, schaeferflight.com, for more details. I'm Jeff Schaefer. Thanks for watching.